Penguin Random House Audio presents Cyber Shogun Revolution by Peter Tieryas. Read for you by Emily Wu Zeller. This book is dedicated to Misa Morikawa, super agent, who moves mechas and mountains alike. Author's note. Cyber Shogun Revolution is a standalone book set in 2019 of the Mecha Samurai Empire universe. There are new characters, new conflicts, and a whole new brew of mechas. You don't need to have read either Mecha Samurai Empire or United States of Japan to read this one, but you do need to know that the Axis forces won World War II back in the late 1940s, and that the Nazis and the Japanese Empire divided America in half. Part 1. The Conspiracy of the Sons of War. Reiko Morikawa. Taiko City. Winter 2019. 1. Reiko Morikawa hated the rain. It reminded her of cold, damp nights full of regret. But she'd been ordered to Taiko City, once called Seattle by the old Americans, for an urgent meeting of the Sons of War. Taiko City looked more dazzling on rainy nights. There were skyscrapers gleaming in vibrant neon, vying for attention with flashy brand logos. Advertisements that were the size of buildings flipped between new portical games, Queequeg's coffee, and various sushi chains that were expanding quickly thanks to breakthroughs in the farming of genetically modified super tuna. Many of the pedestrians were dressed in stylish storm kimonos, while others went for Z-cloaks that could change optics to match a given season's fashion trends. Motorcycles zipped by in a frenetic dash, their lights echoing like trails from the past. Reiko spotted a patrol of two of the newer Anubis-class mechas that were designed to protect cities so that tragedies like the Kansas Massacre could never happen again. She'd lived through the massacre, barely surviving in her East Kansas apartment, when the Nazis carried out their sneak attack on the city. Reiko shuddered at the thought. She was glad to arrive early for her meeting with the Sons of War, so she didn't have to dwell on memories of that day. She, like all the others, had to undergo a ritual cleansing. This meant a washing of hands and feet, then changing into new clothes that included a no-mask wrapped tightly around her face. Audio recorders were built into each of the masks and acted as a voice recognition system designed to ensure the people behind the mask were who they said they were. If they weren't, tactile probes on the insides of each mask would become needles and kill the intruder instantly. The eye openings in the masks shut as the members were driven to a secret meeting place many kilometers away. Once they arrived, they had to go through another metal detector and be subjected to a full-body search at their destination. The corridors were lit by lanterns. The attendees were asked to take off their slippers when they got on the tatami mats and entered the main hall. Reiko was one of the 47 present, all of whom were wearing no masks. The variety of traditional masks had expanded with the growth of the empire, and the participants wore many types from different regions. The Sons of War usually met in groups of 47, even though there were at least 50 times that number in total. Reiko was wearing an onnamen mask, and she spotted several wearing the ghostly onryos. She knew one of them was her friend from her days at Berkeley Military Academy, Daniela Takemi. Daniela had been the one who'd recruited her to the Sons of War, and her roommate when the Nazis had attacked Kansas. "Nice mask," Daniela said. Reiko replied, "You look very creepy in yours." "We need all the ghosts we can get on our side," Daniela replied. "So we can scare the crap out of our enemies? Hopefully a lot more than just scaring." Reiko's attention quickly went to the member who was wearing a George Washington face mask, white wig, and colonial hat. It was a strange choice considering that the leader of the Sons of War, General Noboru Yamaoka, had vanquished the GW threat over a decade ago in the Irvine Trap. Was there a special significance to its presence at this meeting? There very well could be, since pomp and drama were an important part of these ceremonies.
Weird, right?
Daniela asked when she noticed the subject of Reiko's attention.
We should tar and feather them.
Reiko grimaced.
Don't be so nervous, Daniela said. We've been waiting a long time for tonight.
I know, Reiko replied, then looked down at her artificial arm that was covered with genetically grown skin to appear mostly natural. She flexed her fingers and said,
It feels like it's been forever since Kansas. Forever and a half. But it'll be over soon.
Reiko wasn't so sure. The meeting began with a hymn and prayer to Ieyasu, first shogun of the Tokugawa shogunate. The old military dictator had united Japan and brought peace to the main island after years of turmoil. He was the de facto ruler of Japan and made all the key decisions. General Yamaoka revered the old shogun, even painting the crest of the triple hollyhock, Mon, for his personal mecha when he was promoted to general. Even though General Yamaoka did not identify himself as such, everyone knew it was him when he spoke at the meeting. His booming voice, his stoic mask, and his impassioned pose left no doubt.
We are patriots. We are here because we love our country. Our governor bribed his way into power by feeding lies to Tokyo Command. He has never served in the military. He is a liar, a conceited buffoon who has no regard for life. It is because of his lack of leadership that the Kansas massacre was allowed to happen. And worse, in his attempt to save face, he tried to blame others, including our esteemed intelligence community. So many of our most respected colleagues were unceremoniously dismissed or forced to commit seppuku for sins they did not commit. Now we have incontrovertible proof that he is collaborating with the Nazis. The Nazis, our sworn enemies. We cannot leave the fate of our country in the hands of fools. We have taken an oath to each other to wrest control away from Tamura and establish a new government. Anything less, and we'd be shirking our responsibilities.
The general's voice was mesmerizing as he led them through the crimes committed by Governor Tamura. Some minor, others sacrilegious, immoral, and inhuman. General Yamaoka named all the officials and soldiers the governor forced to kill themselves solely for political expediency. The general had firsthand experience of the governor's influence. Shortly after the Kansas massacre, Yamaoka had devised the plan to take over Texarkana Fortress in the German Americas. The campaign succeeded beyond the expectations of the political leadership. Yamaoka conquered Texarkana, smashed the infamous Hitler statue that was purportedly the third tallest structure in the German Americas, and broadcast his victory to the world. The Nazis had been helpless against the new strand mechas that made mincemeat of their biomechs. But rather than follow up their victory with a march all the way to the East Coast, their governor, Daigo Tamura, incited Tokyo Command to question Yamaoka's intentions. This had led to all sorts of political fallout.
It's time for us to make our move, Yamaoka asserted. We've prepared so long for this moment. The poor leadership of those in command has put everyone at risk. The Nazis will never know their place, and even now they're making preparations for a retaliatory excursion against our forces in the quiet border. We've tried rapprochement when I was forced to relinquish the eastern half of Texarkana Fortress. Command wants us to give up the western half too, but that's only convinced the Nazis that the Empire is weak. They weren't wrong. Our political leaders have made one mistake after another, starting with our losses in San Diego. No one survives an alliance with the Nazis, not without the use of force. We will take control of our country before our so-called leaders throw it away.
Reiko knew the implications of what that meant thanks to the Kansas massacre. The fact that General Yamaoka's attempt to avenge her compatriots had been stopped by Tamura still disgusted her, as did the revelation he'd been paid off by the Nazis. She trembled in rage just thinking about it.
The commanders of 18 of the outposts in the 9th section of the Quiet Border have all agreed to be part of the revolution.
An officer confirmed.
The fire chiefs at the 13 local regions are ready for any contingency in case there's a mishap.
30 members went down the list, confirming all those who would take part in the revolution that would follow after the death of Governor Daigo Tamura. General Yamaoka said,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description."